with humble beginnings. Rising to become one of the greatest powers of its day, with its legacy still cherished to this day. An 8-part series, The Rise and Fall of the State of Qing. Comprehensive survey of Chinese architecture. A close examination of the intricate details. 3 years of filming in high definition across much of China. Both informative and authoritative, this is ancient Chinese architecture. On January 3, 1850, an imperial transport arrived at the port of Changsha in Hunan province. On board was 65-year-old former imperial commissioner Lin Zexu. Lin Zexu was a native of Fuzhou in Fujian province and was planning to return there on retiring as governor of Yunnan and Guizhou when he stopped in Changsha. However, Lin's name will be forever associated with Canton. It was there in 1839 that his actions in trying to suppress the opium trade would catapult China into its century of humiliation. Confrontation with the Western powers, and in particular, Britain's Royal Navy, dramatically exposed how out-of-date China's civilian and military technologies had become. In Changsha, Lin was to meet with 38-year-old Zor Zongtang, a man who was later to take up the challenge that Lin's Canton misadventure had posed. Zor Zongtang would write in his memoirs that the night the currents flew westward and the ship stopped by Mount Yualu, the noises of the wind and waves resounded with the conversations of men. As the Industrial Revolution rushed ahead in Europe and America, Asia was left behind. In 1866, the Battle of Lissa between Italy and Austria saw the first major engagement of ironclad warships. The same year also saw the laying of a new high-speed transatlantic telegraph cable that could transmit a full 8 words per minute, a marked improvement over the first cable of 1858. In 1867, the destructive power of modern technologies made a great leap forward with Alfred Nobel's invention of dynamite. In 1853, Japan too had found itself confounded by the superiority of Western military technology when the United States Commodore Perry demonstrated his ship's firepower in Tokyo Bay. Japan's efforts to modernize initially showed no great success, but in 1868, under the Meiji Restoration, a dramatic reversal of fortune was to begin. In China, Zhou Zongtang, now Governor General of Fujian, sent a proposal to the Emperor in the Forbidden City. In his proposal, Zhou Zongtang pointed out how important it was to establish a modern navy to resist the possible invasion by Western powers. To this end, he suggested building an arsenal and naval academy to study how to build battleships and to establish a modern navy. In his proposal, Zhou Zongtang was following the example of Lin Zexu. Twenty years earlier, the emperor, Dao Guang, had dismissed Lin's ideas as complete nonsense. Zhou had built his reputation defending the Qing throne from the Taiping rebels in the 1850s and early 60s. But he had no idea if his loyal track record and success would exempt him from the sort of excoriation heaped on the now deceased Lin Zexu. Power in the court was in the hands of the Empress Dowager Cixi. She had seen firsthand how weak China's military had become from the failure of her husband, the Emperor Xian Fung's forces in the Second Opium War. The Dowager Empress Cixi, acting as a regent, decided to support Zhou Zongtang's proposal. She further began to favor the progressive faction at court, led by Prince Gong, and appointed Zheng Guofan, Li Hongzheng, and Zhou Zongtang to important positions. The reformers were leaders of the self-strengthening, whose objectives were primarily to improve China's military capabilities. They planned and built munitions factories and arsenals, purchased weapons from the West, and set about creating a modern navy. The period became known as the Tongjia Restoration. The dissolute teenage emperor was little involved.
第二次鸦片战争以后，清政府已经意识到我们需要一支近代化的海军，因为坚船利炮造成的这种教训实在是太惨痛了，叫根深蒂固创巨痛深，是吧？圆明园一把火都烧掉了，啊，所以他想到要建立一支近代化的海军，但是这不是海权意识的表现，他只是建立一支海军，防止外来的侵略，继续关起大门来闭关自守，所以他没有海权意识，是吧？他建的是海防，而不是海权。
In 1863, a Briton, Robert Hart, was appointed Inspector General of China's Imperial Maritime Customs Service, IMCS, a post he was to hold for the next 47 years. Hart and Prince Gong held each other in high regard, and it was on Hart's recommendation that the prince sought to purchase British-built gunboats to combat Taiping rebels on the Yangtze. Previous year, the court had set aside 920,000 silver tiles to purchase 7 vessels. Robert Hart's predecessor as Inspector General, another Briton, Horatio Nelson Lay, was entrusted with arranging the purchase. In Britain, Lay appointed Captain Sherard Osborne to command the flotilla. When it arrived in China in September 1863, Osborne refused to take any orders from local Chinese officers, stating that any Chinese orders must come directly from Emperor Tongjia, as transmitted via Lei. The Imperial Court refused to ratify this. The impasse was absolute.
觉得这个是一个烫手的山芋，我们根本超出了我们的想象力，不是说随便能把这个船开起来的，这个冒烟的蒸汽军舰说就随随便便就能开起来，它是需要有一个系统的，经过这样教育培训的人才能够去操纵它的，所以这样来了以后是完全是慌了，然后是李泰国他也抓准了，你中国肯定不懂这个，没有人管这个，所以他把这些所有的岗位上的人都已经安排的，就是一个不落，全部安排好了。
The Qing court was frustrated to learn that they had no ability to command this new fleet. They took the view that they'd rather write off the millions invested than accept a force controlled by foreigners under the Lei Osborne arrangement. In November, a frustrated Osborne resigned and disbanded the flotilla. It had not fired a single shot in anger. The ships were sent back to England for auction. The Qing dynasty's first effort to acquire a modern navy had ended in fiasco.
对，我们过去没有船政，我们没有海军，没有工业，那是一个农业文明状态。恭亲王、曾国藩、李鸿章这一代人呢，就慢慢的寻找一个出路，那怎么办呢？
只有建设自己的海军。Meanwhile, Tsar Zongtang's army was turning the war against the Taiping rebel kingdom in its capital at Nanjing. His victories earned Tsar promotion to governor general of the coastal provinces of Fujian and Zhejiang. This was the perfect opportunity for him to turn his attention to China's naval requirements. As a young man, Tsar Zongtang had repeatedly failed the imperial examinations. Instead, he turned his attention to discover new knowledge outside the limited curriculum of Confucian classics. One book that influenced him deeply was the Wei Yuan, compiled illustrated annals of overseas countries. As Lin's issue before him, Zor Zongtang realized that the Qing dynasty needed to have its own navy and shipyards to protect itself from foreign powers. As Governor General, Zor spent a lot of time inspecting the coastal defenses. Fujian is both a coastal province and very mountainous. As such, much of the population's livelihood was derived from the sea. At the beginning of the 15th century, the great fleet that Ming Admiral Zheng He had used to explore the Indian Ocean had been built in Fujian. Its ports had been part of the Silk Road of the Sea from the beginning of the empire. It was renowned for producing seafarers. These human and natural resources convinced Zor Zongtang that it was there that the Qing should build their new modern shipyard. However, periodic isolationist policies over the centuries meant that China was at a serious disadvantage in maritime matters compared to its rivals. Zor Zongtang knew that to build a modern navy, China would have no choice but to rely on help from Western countries. Zor needed to purchase machines and hire foreign engineers to build his ships. His proposal to the court in June 1866 had to tackle this sensitive issue head on. He wrote that the wisdom of China applies to the metaphysical world, while the intelligence of other countries works in the physical world. Contrary to China, the foreign countries emphasize science over philosophy. His proposal, that out of sheer practicality, China should borrow help from the Western countries to build its own navy, was enough to save face. In fact, he had been in discussion for over a year with his French friend, Prosper Marie Jagel, and others. Prosper Marie Jagel was a French naval officer who had arrived in China in 1856. He studied Chinese and had worked in the Imperial Maritime Customs Service in Ningbo, Shanghai, and Hankou. In 1862, he had helped Zor Zongtang organize the anti-Taiping ever-triumphant army. Jagel and Zor had campaigned together against the rebels. Jagel was to be joined in the naval project by his colleague, Paul Alexandre Neveu de Ajoubel. In the fall of 1864, Prosper Jagel and Zor Zongtang began to discuss how to establish a modern navy for China.
His diary, he describes the interview with Zor Zongtang. And he says Zor Zongtang is extremely warm with him. And he says also that Zor Zongtang is very simple. He's not a very haughty official. He's not full of himself. He says also that the yamen of Zor Zongtang is very simple, much more simple than the ordinary yamens of other officials. There is not much luxury and so on.
On a fine autumn day, Zor Zongtang invited Prosper Jigel and Ajubel to Westlake in Hangzhou to show his French guests a Chinese-made steamship. After watching the steamship make its way across the lake, the two Frenchmen were impressed. He showed me a steamship made by the Chinese and two of the tools used in its construction. He told me a man in his 60s made the ship with those tools. I replied that it is very good. It means the Chinese are very intelligent. Jigel pointed out that China had no ability to make steam engines, which were crucial to the manufacture of battleships. He then showed Zor Zongtang a French book on ship manufacture and suggested that the Qing court should consider ordering engines from Europe. He offered to take care of the communication between the Chinese government and a French manufacturer, which he recommended.
In 1849, France 刚才我用了一个词叫做主要动力，它一方面本身是用了它的主动力是用蒸汽机，但是同时它依然保留了在船上保留了风帆作为它的辅助动力。那么真正去掉这个风帆，以蒸汽机作为自己唯一动力的，大概应该是在19世纪的70年代以后。
Zor Zongtang was impressed by this French technology and commissioned Jigel and d'Ajubel to help the Chinese government purchase steam engines and hire naval architects from France. In early 1866, d'Ajubel returned to China first with a plan he and Jigel worked out concerning ship manufacture and naval training. In the meantime, China was negotiating with Great Britain over modern battleship operation and naval strategy.
As a 海军的最强国家，作为日不落帝国的最主要的支柱，英国海军在当时世界海军当中。
With the late Osborne misadventure in mind, Zor Zongtang emphasized the importance of training the necessary human operational resources rather than simply ship manufacture itself. For fear that there may be no Chinese eligible for commanding and operating the ships, which will force us to hire foreigners to fill those positions, we should elucidate in our contract that the instructors are responsible for teaching shipbuilding, along with crew training, and familiarizing their Chinese students with foreign ports. As the training deepens in the future, we will have more human resources than we can deploy. In this proposal, Zor Zongtang, for the first time, also warned the court of the menace of Japan. Japan had already begun purchasing battleships. They tore them apart, studied their structure, and tried to imitate it. After this ended in failure, they sent men to the British Isles to study its language and technology. In a few years, Japan will be making its own battleships. Zor Zongtang learned that in 1861, 5 years before his proposal to the Qing court, Japan already established a modern shipyard in Nagasaki. In 1864, Sakamoto Ryoma, a prominent figure in the Bakumatsu period, helped establish the Kobe Naval Training Institute, which adopted British naval training techniques. When Wei Yuan's illustrated Annals of Overseas Countries was published in China in 1843, few people showed any interest in it. When it was published in Japan in 1851, it quickly became popular. In 10 years, it was reprinted 15 times, and its price tripled in that time.
中国人就是不理会这本书，这本来是林则徐、魏源为了启蒙中国人编的这本书，因为他不仅介绍了武器，还介绍了当时世界各个州啊、各个国家的状况，因为他觉得我们对这些，林则徐开始对这英国哪来的什么一搭档，觉得我们完全不了解，要了解敌人，介绍这本书，中国人整个不接受。这本书马上传到日本了，林则徐、魏源为了启蒙中国人的书，开始没有启蒙到中国人，无意中启蒙了日本人，是日本又成了一个强国，反过头来侵略中国。
For centuries, Japanese pirates had raided China's coastal regions, but the rapid growth of the Japanese Navy made Tsar Zongtang truly worried. However, he was not sure if the court would take his proposal seriously. The reply was surprisingly prompt. In less than 20 days, he received a response on behalf of the emperor. The way to strengthen China is entirely in spiritual enlightenment, freedom from old customs and habits, and pursuit of practical knowledge. Tsar Zongtang was praised for his insight and given permission to appropriate funds from the tax income of Fujian to establish his shipyard and hire the right man to take charge of the project. The imperial decree emphasized the purpose of the endeavor was to ensure that China could learn how to build and operate its own modern warships. The Qing dynasty was becoming aware of the need to strengthen their defenses in the face of rising foreign powers. But such a complex project could not be achieved simply by dreaming. Gratified by the supported response on behalf of the emperor, Tsar Zongtang wrote to Prosper Zhigel, inviting him to oversee the technical aspects of the project.
这个洋务派因为办这些企业的时候或者办学堂的时候，他说中国完全没有这种人才，都不知道该怎么办，所以他们很大胆，聘请了每个人都是聘请了洋教习。
In August 1866, the 31-year-old Zhigel arrived in Fuzhou for the first time. In this hottest season of the year, the shade of the city's banyan trees provided welcome relief. Having not met for 2 years, Tsar Zongtang and Zhigel renewed their friendship over cups of cooling jasmine tea as they discussed their plans for this ambitious project.
So when
就是高新聘请这一个作为正监督，聘请德克碑作为副监督，啊，双方共同管理，啊，阳江、阳教西，那么再要包教包会我们的，这个工匠，啊，跟学生，啊，确定5年时间造船舶16艘，那初步的经费呢，确定300万，300万两。
As the plans for the project progressed, one major issue remained unresolved: funding. The imperial decree allocated funds to be taken from the maritime customs revenue of Fujian. However, Fujian's revenues would in no way be adequate to meet this demand. Zor Zongtang turned to another friend of his, Hu Xueyan. Hu Xueyan was a fabulously wealthy merchant and businessman with interests in banking, real estate, shipping, the silk trade, and Chinese medicine. In 1864, when Zor Zongtang recaptured Hangzhou from the Taipings, the populace was starving. Hu Xueyan used his influence to deliver food and other relief supplies to the city. The imperial court recognized this contribution by awarding him the red-topped hat of a first-grade official, an honor no merchant had ever received before. Zor Zongtang recommended to the court that Hu Xueyan be appointed as financial advisor to the project. The city of Fuzhou is located upriver of the Min Estuary. From ancient times, it had been famous for the jadeite in its mountains. In the summer of 1866, Zor, Hu, and Zhigel inspected hundreds of ports and gulfs in the Fuzhou area, searching for the ideal for China's first modern naval base. As an experienced naval officer, Zhigel believed that Mawei's geographical advantages made it the clear first choice.
Because Mawei is a natural land port, it's a river port. It's not different from other ports. Its supply conditions are very good. And one thing, it's one of China's three major wood markets. In history, 造船都非常好的一个地方，再一个就政治考量了，是吧？在民族总督这个底下，管理方便。Zor
Zongtang was well educated in traditional Chinese subjects, from literature to military strategy, but he knew little of the commercial contracts used in the West. With Hu Xueyan's guidance, he and Zhigel signed a detailed contract for the establishment of an arsenal. The contract stipulated that Zhigel and Azhabel, as director and deputy director of the project, would manage a group of 36 European instructors and engineers under Zor Zongtang's supervision. The term of their engagement was 5 years, and it was explicitly specified in the contract that these European employees were not allowed to abuse their Chinese students or employees in any way.
he would not be able to import some of the machinery to China. So there needed to be, it to be an official French document saying that everything was okay at the contract. So the contract was signed not by Zongtang himself, but by Hu Guanyong, who was a merchant who was closely linked to Zongtang and lending him money and so on, and helping him for a lot of things.
While Zor Zongtang was negotiating for the establishment of his naval base in Fujian, the Qing dynasty was once again threatened by rebellion, this time in the northwest. In October 6, Zor Zongtang received the order making him governor of Shanxi and Gansu in order to suppress the rebels. This left him deeply concerned for the future of his dockyard and academy at Mawei.
The
野蛮的落后的思想还占统治地位，要能够抵挡住那个来自社会上层的这些非议和阻力啊，没有相应的声望和地位的人是不能抵挡的。1866年10月，左宗棠他就跟朝廷提出，要在马尾设一个机构，叫总理传政事务衙门，这个级别很高，同时任命传政大臣。
传政大臣的权限级别相当于总督这一类，这样的话，新总督来的，但是他不可能太过分的压制传政大臣。Before the provincial governor was sworn in, Zor Zongtang selected Shen Baojian as the best candidate for the position of Minister of Naval Affairs. Three Lanes and Seven Alleys was a famous neighborhood in Fuzhou and home to many generations of literati families. It was where Shen Baojian grew up. For his achievements in campaigning against corruption, and his naval project would require a leader both able and self-disciplined. But when Zor approached Shen on the matter, Shen turned him down. Zor is supposed to have called on Shen four times, all in a vain effort to get him to accept the post.
Because Shen 对于他来说，船政是个陌生和全新的领域，他担心触动传统阻力太大，自己也不如左宗棠，熟悉洋人，担心沟通不畅。最重要的顾虑就是，这件事情前无古人，谁也不知道这件事情怎么做。沈葆桢，你从他的那个知识的积累，你可以看得出来的。 他跟这个造船是八竿子打不着的，从来没有接触过这样的事情，他也没有在沿海省份干过这样的巡抚，也没有主持过水师的建设，也没干过海防的事情。
更不用说近代化的造船了。
As time for his departure inland to the northwest grew close, Zor Zongtang turned to the emperor for help. In his petition, Zor asked the emperor to decree personally to Shen Baojian that Shen should take up the post of the Minister of Naval Affairs and grant him the privilege of reporting to the emperor directly to avoid interference by other government departments. The decree was promptly dispatched, and when 20 days later Shen Baojian received this decree, he had no choice but to accept. He simultaneously learned that compared with other arsenals established in Shanghai and elsewhere, this project was far larger in scale and scope. The emperor's decree specified Shen Baojian was trusted with the naval affairs, not simply a naval arsenal. Unlike a local arsenal, the Office of Naval Affairs was a pillar of central government under the Qing dynasty, responsible for ship manufacturing, naval training, and deployments.
而是一个正式的一个国家的一个机器的当中的一个部分。那么在当时讲来呢，这个也是非常破天荒的，因为清政府的当时的官制当中就是哪一级官、哪些职位都是在那个他的整个制度当中都是设计的非常清晰的。那么，左宗棠因为一定要推动这样的一个事情，那么凭他自己的影响力，而且他是把这个职位呢是安排了一个巡抚级的官员来做，也就体现了福建船政有一个非常高的地位。
In the meantime, Zor Zongtang's financial advisor, envoy Hu Xueyan, met with French consul Brenier de Montmorin in Shanghai. Hu convinced the consul that the Fujian Arsenal project had the emperor's full support. On December 11, 1866, just prior to his departure from Fuzhou, Zor Zongtang wrote two proposals to the emperor on the same day, outlining in detail the state of affairs, from the import of machines from Europe to the recruiting of foreign engineers and instructors. He reiterated the vital importance of the training of Chinese personnel. To this end, he proposed the ministry should set up a naval academy focused on science and technology, as well as other subjects of practical use. Part of Zor Zongtang's proposal was to select intelligent young people to study foreign languages, text and mathematics, and who could eventually be trained to be scientists and engineers. On December 16, 1866, Zor Zongtang left Fuzhou for the northwest to join the fight against the Nian rebels. a devoted servant of the Qing court. He was ready to serve in any way he could to preserve the empire. On December 23, 1866, the bell of the Dingguang Temple was rung to announce the opening of an unusual examination. In the years to come, these students would make their mark on China's history. They were to be the spearhead of the modernization of their motherland.